And Rick can attest to that, and Richard. And so you sort of get to see the big picture of how everything is coming together, which may be something that you guys may not get to see because you're not oftentimes plugged in to each individual throughout the church on a personal level like a pastor is. But I want to tell you this. God is moving mountains. He is providing a way for this church, and it is wonderful. It's amazing to sit back and to be able to see it all happen. You guys understand what I'm saying? Just to watch Him move and just the privilege to watch Him work in the lives of this group collectively. Guys, there's nothing like it in the world. The Lord is blessing us. Amen? The Lord is blessing us. I tell you, it's amazing to see the Lord work in a way here in the last couple of weeks, because 3 weeks ago, I guess it was, or 2 weeks ago, this is part three of the new sermon series entitled Just Pray. But we began this series, and then I find out that I think last Wednesday, Ron taught on prayer. Amanda's Sunday school class is moving into prayer and their class, and you know, here we are as a group collectively focusing on this. And guys, it's a blessing to be able to see that. Just there's some cohesion that exists in this church, folks, that it just don't exist everywhere you go. You understand what I'm saying? As I want to tell you this, just right out of the gate, we need to understand that prayer is the single most important thing that we can do as a church and as Christian individuals. You say, Chris, is it more important than evangelism? Is it more important than knocking on doors? Is it more important than witnessing? What about Good News Club? What about the soccer league? What about preaching? Is it more important than those things? Listen, all of those things are equally important and vital to the church, but without prayer, those things will not be nearly as effective that they can be. Folks, prayer is what sets the things that we do as a church into motion, which is why we must begin and we must end everything in prayer. Now, the last 2 weeks, we've spent mainly examining how to pray by using the Acts formula of prayer. That we should come to Him with adoration, that we should come to Him with confession and thanksgiving and supplication. And this morning we're going to sort of continue that trend of how we should pray by saying that we need to take that Acts formula of prayer, and we need to take it, and we need to take it into our closet. Amen? So I want you to flip over there to Matthew chapter 6 with me. Matthew chapter 6. If you'll remember, in part one of this series, I ended that message with several different visions or several different hopes that I had for this church. And one of those visions that I had for this church was that each and every single one of us would find a closet, that we would find a place that we can go without interruption to have prayer and fellowship with the Father. And you need to understand something this morning, that's not easy. It requires discipline. And folks, a disciplined prayer life is going to take effort on your end. Disciplined prayer is intentional prayer. It is scheduled prayer. It is prayer that is planned out, meaning that you have set aside a time or you set aside a place to spend time with God the Father. Now I want you to look here in Matthew chapter 6. If you're there, say amen. Starting in verse 5, the Scripture says this, "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they should be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask Him." Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this day that you've given us. Father, thank you so much for each and every single one that's here today. The teachers, the workers, Father, each one, we just want to thank you and praise you for them. Father, we pray that today that your word would go forth. Father, we're thankful for the promise that it, when it goes forth, it does not return void. Father, give us the ability this morning to take this word and apply it to our hearts, apply it to our lives, that we may be conformed to the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. We love you. We thank you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And amen. Now, guys, we define prayer in its simplest form as talking or conversing with God. And we have said that prayer is the primary way that the believer in Jesus Christ conveys his or her desires unto the Father. And guys, those things are true. We've used those definitions for the last 2 weeks, but it's actually much deeper than those definitions. Prayer is also pouring out your heart unto God the Father. It is pouring out your soul as a free will offering unto God because you know Him, because you love Him, and because you serve Him, and because you want His will to be done, and you want to bring glory unto God. True prayer is always done out of those motives. This passage right here in Matthew chapter 6, I want to focus on the first two verses. And what Jesus is saying here in this passage is that it is completely possible to pray with the wrong motives. We need to understand that our motives are absolutely everything. In everything that we do, motives are everything. I'm referring to why you are doing what you are doing. The Apostle Paul said this. He said, "Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory." Motives are everything, you see. "But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves." At the beginning of this chapter here, Matthew chapter 6, Jesus said, "Take heed that you do not your alms before men." That means be aware of practicing righteousness before men so that you may be seen. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Guys, motives are everything. Why we do what we do. And folks, I want to talk about the motive of prayer because the same thing rings true within our prayer lives. James chapter 4 and verse 3 says this, "You ask and receive not because you ask amiss." That means that your motives are all wrong. "That they may consume it upon your lust." You want only what brings you pleasure. James is saying you ask and don't receive because you do not have the right motives. You're only asking because it brings you something that you want, gain or pleasure. Jesus says in this passage in verse 7, I want you to look down there, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 7, that our prayers can be shallow, that they can be fake and phony, they can be insincere. He says, "But when you pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking." Guys, in other words, don't use filler whenever you pray. Don't use empty and meaningless words when you pray. Everybody tends to think that more is better. Anytime somebody stands up to pray in public, we think, man, I need to pray. I need to make this last at least 30 or 40 seconds. That way it sounds good. Guys, more is not always better. You may pray for quite a long time, and that's fine. Jesus Christ prayed all night long, but the issue isn't quantity. The issue is quality. He wants you to pray from your heart. John Bunyan said this, "In prayer, it is better to have heart without words than words without heart." God does not want our empty and meaningless words. He doesn't need them. So prayer, first of all, folks, it can be insincere. I want you to look there in verse 5. It can also be hypocritical. He says this, "But when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corner of the streets, that they may be seen of men." Folks, a hypocrite is someone who presents themselves in a way that is not true. They are actors. They are role players. In this particular case, Jesus is speaking of a person that puts on a mask so that they can appear spiritual to other people. And just like all hypocrites, there's going to be times when their true colors are going to come shining through. And in this particular situation, it comes shining through on their prayers. Now, the first century Jews, the Pharisees,
they would pray three times a day. They would pray at 9 a.m., they would pray at noon, and they would also pray at 3 p.m. That's the third hour, the sixth hour, and also the ninth hour. They would either gather together to pray in the synagogues, or they would pray wherever they happened to be at during those hours of prayer. So if they happened to be standing on the corner of the street whenever that time came, that's where they prayed. And what Jesus is saying here is that these hypocrites would position themselves in public places so that when they prayed, other people would hear them and be impressed. You see, that was their motive. And folks, this gives us a picture of how deceitful that the human heart can really be. Here we have a call to prayer, which is one of the highest and most honorable things that we can do as human beings, having the privilege to talk to the Creator of this universe. But it was not done to glorify God. It was not done to honor Him. It was done in order to be seen by men in order to impress other people. Now the text goes on. It says this, "For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corner of the streets, that they may be seen of men." Jesus is saying this, if the love for prayer is grown out of a love for being seen and so that others will be impressed, then you have your reward. You have it. That word that's used there for reward, it's the Greek word misthos, which means you have been paid in full. It means that you have absolutely everything that you have coming to you. Here's what we need to understand. We need to understand that it is, before we look down our nose on these individuals, that it is very easy to do exactly what Jesus is talking about right here. And if we're honest with one another, I bet you every single one of us has been guilty of this in some way, especially whenever you pray publicly. You see, because when you pray publicly, there is a temptation to choose your words carefully in order to do a good job, in order to impress other individuals. Sometimes we pray to edify other people, to build people up. And what we do is we'll throw a little bit of instruction in there. We'll throw a little bit of teaching in there along the way. And folks, when we do that, when we pray in that way, we're not talking to God. We're talking to other men in the pretense of talking to God. Sometimes us as preachers, we try to preach a good prayer. That's what we do. Sometimes we'll close in prayer at the end of a sermon and just hit those 3 points that we had. Almost like God didn't hear us preach. Almost like God had no idea the message that I just brought. I'm guilty of that. You see, what I'm trying to do when I do that is I'm trying to pound the message into the heads of the individuals that are sitting in the congregation. That's what I'm doing. But that's not prayer. That's not what it is. 1991, ABC News investigation team investigated a TV evangelist. I'm not going to mention his name because it's not important. Many of you guys may remember this. But he was pictured laying on top of a bed of mail. And he's laying on top of it with his arms out. And he's got tears coming down his eyes. Like he's got this huge burden for these prayer requests that he's laying on top of. When in fact, he was only opening the mail, taking out the check, and throwing the prayer request, folks, in the dumpster behind the church. That's what he was doing. He didn't care about those prayer requests. He didn't even care about prayer. It didn't matter. The only thing that mattered to him was the $80 million a year that he was receiving from his listeners. Do you know why we send out prayer requests in this church? It's not so you guys can know what's going on in everybody's lives. That's not why we send out prayer requests. Oh, did you hear so-and-so's got this going on? Did you hear so-and-so's got this going on? No, we send out prayer requests because there's power in prayer and we want you to take those requests and sit down and pray over top of them. That's why we send them out. Amen? Jesus is asking us in this passage to examine our motives. If your motive is to be seen whenever you pray, He says, then you have your reward. If your motive is just to fulfill some sort of Christian obligation, then He says, you have your reward. If your motive is self-seeking in some way, then you have your reward. God wants us to come to Him in faith. Folks, He wants us to come to Him with a pure heart, and He wants us to come with pure motives. You see, whenever we come to Him in secret, or when we pray in our closet, it reveals the true intent of our hearts. And Jesus is making clear right here, the issue is with the heart. That's where the issue lies. It's with our motives. Why do we pray certain prayers? Why? You know, if you're praying for your spouse to be more Christ-like, I probably shouldn't use this example. But if you're praying for your spouse to be more Christ-like, is it because you want her to be more Christ-like to glorify Him, or is it because you want life to be easier for you? I mean, I think you guys understand what I'm talking about. It's a terrible example. My wife is Christ-like, I think. But you guys understand what I'm talking about. What is your motive? What is your motive whenever you pray? He wants us to come to Him out of a desire to come to Him with adoration and confession and thanksgiving and supplication. He wants us to come to Him out of necessity because we crave Him and we want more time with Him. That's why He wants us to come. Our motives are everything, church. Amen? I want you to look down at verse 6. The Scripture says this, "But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to the Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." Now the word there that's used for closet, it's an inner room, it's a chamber, it's a place that's without windows that people cannot see in. So you go in that place, you shut the door, you're not trying to impress your wife, you're not trying to impress your husband, you're not trying to impress your kids, you just have a desire to be alone with God. You want one-on-one time with the Father. And Jesus wants us to go to our closet. He wants us to go to a place, folks, that is without distraction, a place that we can communicate with Him and have fellowship with Him. And listen to me, and listen very careful. It is not the place that is sacred. It is the privacy that is sacred. It's not the place, it's the privacy. We're to pray in secrecy. We're to have intimacy with God and to have a closeness with God. You and Him spending time together one-on-one. How in the world can you say that you love an individual if you never spend time with them? How can you say with a straight face that you love your earthly father if you never talk to your earthly father? Maybe once a year you send him a card on Father's Day or something like that. Folks, that's not love. If you love your earthly father, you're going to want to speak with him. You're going to want to talk to him at some point. And look what he says in verse 6. Look at this. Do you notice the scripture? Verse 6, pray to thy father. Pray to thy father. Don't miss this. Do you see the relationship and the fellowship that is portrayed here in this passage? Pray to thy father. It's about setting aside time to spend with your Father, coming to Him, adoration, coming to Him, confession, coming to Him, thanksgiving, supplication, because you love Him and you desire to have more time with Him. The Apostle Paul said this in Galatians, "And because you are sons," because you're sons and daughters, "God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts," listen, "crying, Abba, Father." That simply means daddy. Daddy, that's the relationship. Jesus Christ Himself praying in the Garden of Gethsemane with the cross looming in the horizon. He said this, "Abba, Father, Daddy, all things are possible unto Thee. Take this cup away from Me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but Thou wilt." You see, God is our Father and He desires to have time with you. He desires to have a relationship with you, and He wants you to desire the exact same thing. And that happens through prayer, and it happens through closet prayer. The psalmist said this, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thy heart." Do you understand that? Delight thyself in the Lord. He's talking about prayer. And He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. He wants us to delight in Him, church, and have a hunger for Him, church. Does anyone here this morning hungry? Show of hands, if you're hungry, show me that you're alive out there. Amen. That's what He wants us to have. He wants us to have a desire, and He wants us to have a hunger unto Him. And listen to me. Don't misunderstand me in any way. This passage is not discouraging or downplaying corporate prayer as a church family. That's not what this passage is doing. We can go into the book of Acts and we can see that the early church prayed together often. They did it constantly. Acts 2:42, Acts 12:12, Acts 13:3, Acts 14:23, Acts 20:36. But God wants us as individuals to also set aside time to come to Him and pray one-on-one with God. In the Old Testament, we can see that Daniel, Elijah, Moses, Joshua, David, they all set time aside to go to God the Father in private prayer. Jesus Christ Himself set time aside to remove Himself from the company of His disciples to have private prayer. The Bible says, and in the morning, rising up a great while before day, He went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. Wow. Matthew's gospel, the scripture says this, and when He had sent the multitudes away, He went up into a mountain apart to pray, and when the evening was come, He was there alone. In Matthew chapter 26, Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, He leaves the disciples and He went off by Himself to pray one-on-one with the Father. And folks, that is most of our prayer life. Most of our prayer life should be in private. It should be one-on-one in our closet with the Father. And folks, I already know many of you guys are going to say, I don't have time for that. I just don't have time to set aside for that. Folks, you take time to feed yourself. You take time to clean yourself, at least I hope. You take time for the physical, but what about the spiritual? What about your spiritual needs? Folks, we've got to take time because listen, without this, your relationship with God, you're going to be walking around missing out on all kinds of blessings that He has for your life. Do you know how many Christians are not living a victorious Christian life? They may be saved, but they're not getting everything out of that relationship that can be had because they have no prayer life. And I want you to look what He says in the last part of verse 6. He says, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Reward thee openly. Folks, when we have seen and tasted that the Lord is good, then we will have a desire to go unto Him and to go to Him with a great expectation in our prayer. And folks, we know that the gospel teaches us that Jesus Christ is the basis of absolutely everything that we need. Why? Because we've seen the finished work of Christ at Calvary. We know what's already taken place. We've fallen out of love with ourselves and we've fallen out of love with the praise of men, and now the only thing that we desire to do is lift Him up. It's not about us anymore. It's now about Him. It's about bringing honor and glory and praise unto Him. And folks, so much so that we set aside time to come to Him in closet prayer because we want to receive everything that God has for us through His Son, Jesus Christ. He's our reward. He's our reward. Let me ask you a question this morning. Do you want more of Him? This means yes. I want more of Jesus, Pastor. That's what it means. If you want more of Him, then we've got to learn to set aside time to pray in private, and our motives have got to be correct. Listen to what the Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. For all the promises of God in Him are yea and in Him. That means the promises of God are found in Him. The book of Hebrews says this, for he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. You see, whenever we set aside time for private prayer, we are seeking after God. And the Bible says that God will reward those that do that. Amen. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek. There it is, seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. When we seek the Lord, folks, it means to seek His presence, to literally seek His face, and we are continually supposed to seek after Him. Paul, writing to the Colossians, said, "If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things of above." That means to seek, not on things of the earth. "For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God." Folks, in order to seek Him, there has got to be a conscious effort on your end. Do you know that? Amen, rocks. There's got to be a conscious effort on your end in order to seek after Him. And God wants us to seek after Him through private prayer with the right motives. Why? Because it's through that prayer that the true heart is revealed. The true heart. I want us to be a church that seeks after Him. Not only a church, I want us as individuals that make up this church, that make up this body of Christ. I want us, each and every single one of us, to have that private place that we go to Him in prayer. Folks, we need to make a commitment to do that. We need to make a commitment. You remember the phrase, "Let's do it"? Well, that phrase still exists. I think it's still in the bulletin. Amen? Let's do that. I want to read you a psalm. Psalm chapter 63. Flip over there with me. Psalm 63. This is a prayer of David. The Scripture says this, starting in verse 1, Psalm 63. "O God, Thou art my God." Can anyone say that today? "Early will I seek Thee." What's that word, church? Seek. "I will seek Thee. Early will I seek Thee. My soul thirsteth for Thee." Craves, he says. "My flesh longeth for Thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is, to see Thy power and Thy glory, so as I have seen Thee in the sanctuary." Why? "Because Thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise Thee. Thus will I bless Thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in Thy name." Full surrender, by the way. "My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise Thee with joyful lips. When I remember Thee upon my bed and meditate on Thee in the night watches, because Thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of Thy wings will I rejoice. My soul followeth hard after Thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me. But those that seek my soul," there's that word again, "seek to destroy it, shall go into the lower parts of the earth." "They shall fall by the sword. They shall be a portion for foxes. But the king shall rejoice in God. Everyone that sweareth by Him shall glory. But the mouth of them that speak lies shall be stopped." Wow. That's a prayer. That's a prayer. Sometimes I wonder. I have a book in here in my office. I think I got it from one of the pastor's fellowships. It's Spurgeon's Prayers. Somebody had to take the time to write that down. And I just wonder sometimes if Spurgeon knew that someone was writing down his prayers and if that affected the way that he prayed. If that affected his motive. Would that affect yours? You see, we have the same thing here. This is David's prayer. You see, but I know that his motive is pure here. You know why? Because it's found in the Bible. Yes, that is the book for me. God inspired every single bit of this. And I want to ask you a question that goes back to verse 1. Are you seeking after Him? Early will I seek Him. With all of your heart, with everything that you have, are you seeking after God? Are you seeking a deeper relationship with Him? Are you continuing to grow? In order to do that, folks, you've got to seek Him. He says, "My flesh longs for Thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is." Do you long and seek after Him? Do you crave after Him? If you do, then you ought to be taking aside time to pray to Him. That's what this message is all about. Praying with the right motives and taking the time to do it. I told you guys to put on your seatbelts. It's going to be a difficult series. It's convicting, isn't it? convicting to me. There's another way that you should seek Him. You see, the Bible says this. See, before I was speaking to Christians, now I'm speaking to those of you that aren't Christians. The Bible says, seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near. I want to say this to whoever's here that's not saved. If you're here today, you're not here by accident. I truly believe that. I believe that we serve a sovereign God. The Scripture says to seek the Lord while He may be found. Right now, today, He can be found. He is near. And you may think that you woke up this morning not seeking after Him. But here's the amazing thing that you're going to discover after you give your life to Jesus Christ. You'll find out that you really weren't seeking Him to begin with, that He was actually seeking after you. Woo! Praise God, that gets me excited. Why in the world would He seek after you? Why would He seek after me? Folks, I'm too embarrassed to tell you the things that I've done in my life. Why would He seek after me? I'm nothing. I'm worthless. I'm not deserving. I don't deserve to stand here today and preach His Word. I don't deserve to be your pastor. But why would He do that? Because He loves us. The song that Felicia played during the offering at Calvary. The love that drew salvation's plan. I want you to understand something this morning, that He desires to have a relationship with you. He wants you. The only reason that He has not yet sent His Son back is because He's a patient God and He wants as many individuals to accept His Son Jesus Christ as possible. That's why He hasn't came back yet. He's not slack concerning His promises, as some men count slackness, but He's long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's why He hasn't came back yet. Are you seeking Him? Are you? Ask yourself that question today. Ask yourself this question. Is He seeking you? Think about it. Let's all rise. Father, thank You so much for the time that You've given us here today. Father, thank You so much for Your Word and how it cuts us, how it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Father, we're so thankful for that, Father, because it shows us our need. It shows us where we need to improve. And Father, I know personally in my life that this message right here was for me. Father, I pray that You would purify my motives. Father, I pray that You would give me the desire to set aside more time, Father, to come to You, to have fellowship with You in prayer. Father, give me the ability to be able to do that. Father, we want to thank You for the privilege that we have to come to You in prayer. Father, we ask You, dear Lord, as we're moving forward in the next several weeks, Father, we pray that You would bless us.